Today, I'm going to talk about ISO. After making a few videos on ISO, a few of you commented pointing out my mistakes. I did get a bit of misinformation on ISO, so this video is going to correct those mistakes. There is quite a lot of misinformation about ISO, from its origins to how it works. In my ISO invariance video, I got caught out by this misinformation. Now, this will teach me not to scrimp when it comes to doing research on a certain subject. Now, I've been a photographer since the mid-90s, but I didn't really worry too much about the terms and terminology of photography. So in making these videos, I'm learning a lot about photography, and I hope you are too. I incorrectly said that it was the International Standards Organization. It's actually the International Organization for Standardization. It is an independent, non-governmental organization, the members of which are the standards organizations of the 164 member countries. It is the world's largest developer of voluntary international standards and facilitates world trade by providing common standards between nations. When they first set up the organization, if they'd have used the acronym IOS, then in different languages and different countries, it would have a different acronym. So they settled on ISO. This is short for ISOS, which is equal or the same as in Greek. This is quite clever. Because they're all about standardization, they actually standardized their name and branding. With photography, the International Organization for Standardization came up with a standard for emulsion-based film in the late 70s. You wouldn't want to get a film from a different country or a different brand that had completely different levels. So if companies used this standard, you'd know that ISO 100 from one brand would be the same worldwide, and would also be the same as ISO 100 from other brands when it came to exposure values. In the United States of America, film used to have an ASA number on it. This stood for the American Standards Association. In the early 1940s, the ASA set a standard for film speed for negative black and white film. Originally, ASA values were referred to as American Standard Speed Numbers, or ASA Exposure Index Numbers. In Europe, in the mid to late 1930s, they had the DIN system. This, once again, was all about film speed and how they could standardize it. Since 1974, the ASA and DIN film speed standards have been combined. The arithmetic ISO scale corresponds to the ASA arithmetic system. Therefore, if the ISO number doubles, this refers to the doubling of the sensitivity of the film. You used to see a film with ISO 200/24, or you might have seen ISO 100/21. For a long time now, film and digital cameras follow just with the arithmetic numerical system. The correct way to pronounce it is ISO. I thought it was ISO as in an acronym, but I got this wrong. I'll probably keep pronouncing it like this because I've pronounced it as an acronym for so long, but I'm going to try and correct myself and pronounce it ISO. Nowadays, the term ISO has become synonymous with digital photography. If you want to increase your exposure, you can raise your ISO. If you want to decrease your exposure, you can lower ISO. When you raise your ISO, you're increasing the voltage that runs across the sensor. This amplifies the signal. As you amplify the signal, you'll brighten up your image. But if you push ISO too far, you'll introduce digital noise. As not all cameras are equal, you'll have a signal-to-noise ratio. Some cameras have better signal-to-noise ratios, others have worse. Also, some cameras have ISO invariant sensors. If you're not sure about ISO invariance, click on the eye in the corner. This will take you to another of my videos. Each camera has a base ISO, and this is the best ISO that you can take photographs or film at. Most, but not all cameras have this base ISO set at 100. So if you keep your ISO at 100, you'll get a really good quality image as long as you expose it properly with the other two principal settings. Another way that ISO changes your photograph is when you increase your ISO, your image will become less saturated. This is because as the light drops, increasing the ISO will amplify the signal from the sensor. The amount of light is still dropping, but the ISO is keeping the settings the same by this amplification method. One more thing with ISO, Tony Northrup made a video recently showing how ISO 100 differed from brand to brand, and also within brands on different cameras. This is quite interesting and it's worth a watch, so click on the eye in the corner or the link in the description to his video. However, for most of us, this won't matter too much. If you shoot with one camera, you know what ISO 100 is and you know what ISO 1600 is. You'll get used to the ISO levels in that camera. You might find that when you switch to another brand or another camera or a more modern camera, you may notice the difference. But I never have, but he does have a point that it should be standardized across the cameras when it actually isn't. I tried the test and this is what I found. I have the GH4, the RX10, the RX100, the A7 R2 and the A7 III. Hopefully that's cleared up ISO. In making these videos, every now and then I will make small mistakes, and if you spot any of them, please do comment below. I'm learning so much from making these videos, and it's great to hear that you guys are learning from them as well. And that's about it. So ISO comes from the Greek term isos, which means equal or the same as. When you increase your ISO, you increase the voltage that runs across the front of your sensor, and this amplifies the signal that comes from your sensor. And lastly, it's pronounced ISO and not ISO. As always, if you like what you see, give me a thumbs up. If you didn't, give me a thumbs down. And for weekly tutorials, hints and tips in photography and videography, subscribe and turn on notifications. I'll see you in the next one.